of Old Jolo and Zamboanga, 1260 to 1945. He is a development researcher and educator specializing in Mindanaoan studies, who finished his education degree in social studies at the Ateneo de Zamboanga University and earned his master's degree in social development from Ateneo de Manila University. Full blue. No? He is presently an assistant professor at Western Mindanao State University, WEMSU, and a research fellow of Access Bangsamoro, an online and social media portal for effectively implementing the Bangsamoro Organic Law, or BOL, and transitioning to the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao, or BARM. Friends, let's welcome on stage Mr. Mark Francis Francisco. Hello, hello. Oh, siya po yung author natin sa Old Jolo and Zamboanga. Mamaya pag-usapan natin yan. Next, we have the editor of More Mindanaoan Than We Admit, History, Culture, and Identity in the Philippine South. She is a full professor of literature and creative writing at the University of the Philippines, Mindanao, and is currently serving as the Dean of the College of Humanities and Social Sciences. She also has a PhD from RMIT, University of in Melbourne. She received her Master of Fine Arts in Creative Writing and Master of Arts in Language and Literature, major in English, both with distinction, from De La Salle University, Manila, where she had finished AB in Literature with honors. She also proudly holds the distinction of being conferred UP Artist. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Professor Joanna Lynn Cruz. Hi, ma'am. Hello, hello. Sige. Oh, sige. Batiin muna natin yung ating mga nanonood ngayon dito sa MIBF.
Buenos dias a todos.
Mayang buntag. Mayang hapon sa tanan.
Sige. So, si Mark muna ang tatanungin natin. Mark,
opo.
Ito ang question, no? May overview na tayo dun sa ating... una sa lahat. Old Jolo and Zamboanga, 1268-1945. Paano nagsimula na ang aklat na ito ay maging aklat?
I think 2018, I had a short snack with Sir Gaspar Vival. Then he asked me to write a book. He just told me, I can write you about Zamboanga because I know Zamboanga, because I'm from Zamboanga. Then he told me, hindi, you need to write something about Jolo and Zamboanga. Then, that's how it started during the pandemic. Matagal na po to, so kaya ano, history na po. Ano, wanted na ako sa Vival. So at least ngayon hindi na ako wanted.
Very good. Now. Ito ang ano natin, ano? Meron na tayong chapter overview dito sa aklat mo batay dun sa ating ano, no? From palakpakan ba natin Vival Studios. Vival Studios, ha? May studio ang Vival. Tandaan po natin 'yan. Okay. Ito 'yung tanong ko. Kung, kasi, di ba, may mga ano ka niyan, may mga isinulat ka. Sa palagay mo, kung papipiliin ka at itatanong sa'yo, kasi minsan, di ba, alam mo yung elevator pitch, di ba, in 1 minute, dapat nabenta mo na yung libro mo. Anong highlight ang pipiliin mo sa lahat ng mga naisulat mo to say na this is the, you know, this is what the book is all about?
I think the second to the last chapter, yung highlight, pero meron akong tatlo. But yung first is yung there's a suit. Pwede yung tatlo?
Of course. By all means, the elevator one is long. Maraming floors.
So the first floor, sa ground floor, the book talks about Paduka Batara, a sultan, a Sulu sultan who went to China and died there. No? And then the current old families of Jolo traces their history to Paduka Batara as early as 13th century or 12th century. So until now, if you go to Jolo, there are lots of Moro Chinese families, and they are the old families of Jolo. Then second, the book also talks about the story of Sultan Alimuddin. He's a Sultan of Sulu who, from the Spanish point of view, converted to Christianity, but from the locals' point of view, did not. So that's the story. But again, this is history, so a little bit biased in writings. No? Then third, It also talks about the history of the Moros of Sulu and Mindanao, wherein in the 1920s and the 1930s, as a reaction to the Filipination project of our nation, in the 1920s and 30s, Moro or the people in Sulu and Mindanao would prefer to be part of the United States than to be part of the bigger national project here in Manila. So there was even a U.S. senator who proposed a bill to make Mindanao, Sulu, Palawan, and certain parts of Mindanao part of the United States. But it did not happen because the Sultanate is practicing, it's against the 13th Amendment of the United States. The Sultanate is practicing slavery. So it did not happen. And in the 1940s, well, in the 1939, the war started. So everything was, well, a dream, no? So those three things, sir. I hope.
Ang ganda nun kasi, una, meron ng mga historians, of course, on Zamboanga. Pero sa totoo lang, it's very difficult to find literature on specifically on Molo. No, so that you're able to integrate this in a bigger context of the kumbaga island Mindanao yan eh, na history and yung Moro, no? Kasi when you look at Zamboanga, it's a very diverse city. 'Di ba? Talagang nagsasama doon ang mga Muslim, Kristiyano, no, lumad. So ang ganda-ganda niya. But also, we all know, ito yung stereotyping natin, ano? That compared to now to the more popular or tourist friendly cities in Mindanao like Davao, Jensen or Cagayan de Oro among others, Molo and Zamboanga are often more associated with conflict or security concerns. How central to the history and development of Mindanao are these two cities? So conflict yung sinasabi, yung pero ano yan, meron ba siyang role sa buong development naman ng Mindanao mismo? And siguro, kumusta? Hindi naman itong topic ng Limboma, pero taga doon ka. Kumusta naman sila ngayon?
Ngayon, well, the recent news is yung umalis yung Sulu sa BARM, di ba? Yun yung ano ngayon, yun yung highlight. But the book is about pre-war. Yung nangyari kasi when you talk about peace issues is 60s, 70s, and 80s, no? But I think when you talk about bakit sino po nakapuntang Zamboanga at Mindanao at Molo? Zamboanga, konti lang, no? Molo, walang gustong pumuntang Molo, di ba? May isang dalawang Zamboanga, but wala pang nakapuntang Molo, di ba? Because takot tayo. Well, after the Second World War, you don't want to go. After the Second World War, then the 1960s and 70s, with all the conflict, nobody wants to go to Molo. And then the story, the old memory of the glory of Molo days were gone. That's why I think it's also important for us to talk about who are these people.
Correct.
What is the Sulu Sultanate? Parang ganon. And then ngayon, in line with the Sulu opted to be out of BARM, we see, bakit kaya ganon? They were once part of it and now they wanted to move out. Because there's also a generalization, even the conceptualization of BARM, putting them together is not really an answer, no? Because Sulu, dito po sa book, is basically separate from that of the other sultanates in Mindanao.
Right.
Maguindanao and ano. So, they are more organized and they are more powerful than the Maguindanao. And they were never one. Probably at certain point, nagkaisa sila. But they were never one. They are competitors.
And eh, kaya nga, ang ganda that Vival is actually venturing on publishing books on Mindanao. Because, yeah, we have stereotypes. And ngayon, nakikita natin, it's really complicated, it's colorful. And we will, at least, there's no full account, but at least we will have a window to understand this complexity. Diba? So, siguro, gusto ko lang sabihin din na mga recently, may mga nakapaglakbay ng mga historian sa Sitangkay, sa Sulu area, no? sa Basilan. And I think, nakatulong din yung pagkakaroon ng BARM na nagkaroon ng peace talks. Talagang mukhang ready na rin sila And ang kailangan nila dyan, tourism infrastructure. And this book will help you, and I hope it will also help the people of Mindanao din to see that once before, nung heyday ng Sultanate of Sulu, Sulu was the center of activity, economic activity in the islands nung wala pang Pilipinas. Sulu hindi Manila. Di ba Mindanao? Mindanao, di ba? So, salamat po sa inyong... Mamaya, babalik po tayo sa inyo.
Thank you.
Dito naman tayo. Palakpahan naman natin. Galing-galing nung kanyang research, no? Dito naman po. Puntahan natin si Mama Johanna. Yeah, Johanna. Johanna Lynn B. Cruz. Okay. So, ang tanong ko dito, more Mindanao than we admit. Paano ka nadala sa ganitong di ba parang ano siya, parang ang ganda, daming topics, very complicated. Paano ka nasuot dito?
Magandang tanong ko din sa sarili ko.
Oo, oh, di ba?
But unang-una sa lahat, gusto ko magpasalamat sa inyong dalawa, Mark at Shao, no? Dahil sa inyong mga napaka-generous na blurb para dito sa libro nito.
Oo, kami yung nandito.
Yeah, so sobrang thank you. No?
Mamaya babasahin ko yung sa'yo.
Basahin mo yung sa'yo kasi sobrang yun talaga yung gusto kong gawin dito sa libro when I put it together. So actually, serendipity. Hashtag serendipity. Kung paano ako naging editor at / comadrona no ng librong ito no so last year sa Philippine Book Festival, yung kay Mark sabi niya 10 years na daw in the making, ito 1 year in the making na hindi ko akalain na kakayanin ng Vibal. Thank you so much to Vibal Foundation and team, dahil talagang sabi ni Miss Jello, lalabas sa MIBF, lalabas, no? So eto na siya talagang bravo, no, to the whole team. But yun nga, naanghelan ako nung Philippine Book Festival, napanood ni Ms. Jello yung isang panel where I sat with Resil Mojares, national artist, in which we talked about regional writing and its place in the national imagination. And fortunately, my thoughts, no, about Mindanao and literature caught the imagination, no, of Ms. Jello, and we started initially to talk about the book, no. Gusto nila talagang gumawa ng Mindanao kasi last year na launch yung More Cebuano Than We Admit. So it was time for the Mindanao edition. So, and at that time, sabi niya nga, Mindanao 1, yung AN, no?
Aba, ano yun? Oh, ano kasi, ba yun? May ibig sabihin ba yun? O ano lang yun? Semantic na error lang?
Hindi siya error, no? Kasi more popular yung Mindanao 1. Kasi yun yung... Mindanao AN. No? Kasi yun yung geographical marker. Pero tulad nga ng sabi din ni National Artist Resil Mojares, no, in a keynote lecture about Mindanao writing, it's... hindi lang geographical yung mga identity natin, namin, no, ng mga taga Mindanao. It's also related to how we actively create and imagine who we are in our imagined communities, no? So, pero si Resil, sabi niya, Mindanao 1, yun yung ginamit niya. Kasi yun man yung usual. Pero dito, doon sa amin, sa Davao, there's a group of academics, anthropologists, led by Brother Carl Gaspar, Father Albert Alejo, and the journalist Carolyn Arguillas, who in 2000, wanted to create a physical space for all the research about Mindanao. And then they were talking about what were they gonna call it. And hindi nila gusto yung Mindanao AM, Mindanawan, sa Cebuano, Bakikaw. No? Hindi maganda pakinggan.
Sa oh,
parang we're awkward, no? Parang sintunado.
Parang English kasi yun eh, Mindanawan,
yeah,
eh.
Yeah, so hindi siya tama. Yeah. And so they studied, dahil anthropology sila, no? they studied nga na that the indigenous groups, no, in Mindanao, ON ang dulo. So yun yung nagbukas, no, ng idea na dapat Mindanaoan. Parang ano nga yun, yung hindi siya talaga yung Mindanaoan. Dapat Mindanaoan. Na-mention namin kahapon. But anyway, part of the idea of Mindanaoan is really the diversity, no, of identities, no. So ako, hindi ako native. Na taga Mindanao, taga Lasal.
Taga Lasal.
Taga Maynila, taga Pasay City. Yon. Pero I'm a migrant to Davao. I moved there in 2007 and joined UP Mindanao. So wow. Part of what makes me Mindanaoan and makes me so blessed not to be the comadrona of this book is really the idea that you don't have to be a native.
Yes.
Or a Moro to be a Mindanaoan. And it really has to do with how we actively contribute not to achieving our aspirations as a people and as a community for peace and justice.
Yung aspiring for peace, di ba? Parang Mindanao talaga yan eh. Dahil di ba, sa matagal na panahon yun yung kasaysayan eh. So, when we aspire for peace, there's a little Mindanaoan in all of us. Diba? Parang ganun yan, kaya more Mindanaoan than we admit. Diba? Ang ganda, ang ganda. And this is history will make you become part of something kapag alam mo yung kasaysayan niya. Ganun talaga yun eh. Kaya nga bilang Pilipino, nagbabasa tayo ng ano, ako, at yung mga binabasa ko yung mga sinulat ni Jobbers, sa matagal na panahon, wala talaga akong alam tungkol sa Cebu. Pero pag nasa Cebu ako, I feel so at home because I know the history. At si Rolly Purinaga naman sa Samang Leyte, diba? Pagka binasa mo, pag nandun ka, ay, alam mo kung saan yung lugar, alam mo kung saan, pag nasa Cebu ka, alam mo saan yung Dalaget, diba? Yung mga ganun. So, parang nakakatalino, diba? Kaya kailangan natin na maaklat na ito para tunay tayong maging talagang mga Pilipino, eh. So, sige, 2 minutes lang tayo, pero ito ang tanong ko sa